Hello, welcome to second Turkey Community Webinar. My name is Büşra Osma. I am senior student at Naval Architecture and Marine Engineering Department at Piri Reis University. Today, webinar speaker is Mr. Münircan Sınözden. Münircan Sınözden was born in 1983 in Ankara. He studied Naval Architecture degree in Istanbul Technical University. In 2009, he studied his dissertation under supervision of Professor Dr. Yücel Odabaşı and focused on preliminary design of non-nuclear submarines. In his MCG studies, Özden focused on another submarine-related topic, underwater acoustics, and studied computational and experimental prediction of propeller noise. In his PhD, Özden worked with a successful team in order to design, manufacture, and test the planar motion mechanism and free-running maneuvering systems for Istanbul Technical University's Atanutku Ship Model Testing Laboratory. Özden carries on his research studies in Istanbul Technical University and is co-owner of Datum Submarine Technologies and Applied Engineering Corporation. Today, Münircan Sınözden would like to tell you about comparative naval architecture of modern non-nuclear submarines. During the presentation or after presentation, you can write your questions on question screen. Mr. Johnson's presentation, he will answer your question. Enjoy listening to Mr. Johnson's presentation.
Thank you very much, Büşra. Thank you for giving me the chance to represent my studies. Hello, everyone. My name is Can Sınözden. I'm a naval architect, today I want to talk about the studies we carried out with my colleagues, students from Istanbul Technical University. These are not related to the studies of Turkish Navy. We are just civilians who has passions about submarines and want to dig as far as we can about the science of naval architecture, which focus on submarines. So I will start now my presentation. But before that, let me tell you about the general topics which we will talk about. I will talk about tonight. It is 8 p.m. in Turkish time, so it is evening here. I started to study on this subject about 11 years ago with my Bachelor of Science degree dissertation. Under supervision of Professor Yücel Odabaşı, our late professor. My passion for choosing this topic was to learn about submarines, and I thought it will be good also for Turkey to compare existing designs, but at first we don't. I don't really know where to start and how to make it more efficient or turn this study into a something useful. So I started to search about submarines, and then I. Found I read a lot of books which I can find from Amazon and also I found at that time I had a chance that MIT opened their thesis archive to internet, so I got chance to reach the students' thesis, which studied especially Master of Science under supervision of Dr. Harry Jackson. And this is also important maybe to talk about him. He was a fellow of SNAMI, and he was nominated in 1993 with the David Taylor Medal for Outstanding Contribution to Naval Architecture. Even though I started to study this topic after he died, and I never had a chance to meet him, but he had such a touch in my professional life, which I will talk about today. And also, after my thesis, there were a lot of students in our university who wanted to study about submarines. And after my dissertation, I had chance to work with other students and to improve the studies which I started. And last year, we had Dilşat Karataş and Sertaş Kurdoğlu, who again studied on this subject, and this time for a master's degree. So let's start with some warm-up about submarines. I wish I could show you the designs we did in Turkey, but unfortunately we don't design submarines yet, indigenous submarines. So I will show some about German designs which we are used. As I said, all the images and information is from internet, open sources. I don't have permission to reach other kind of secret files. So and the study which I was done was also to predict the performance and arrangement of submarines from the open source data. So the all the things I will show you today has, of course, the designers and shipyards who build these boats has much detailed information. But as a naval architect, I tried during this dissertation to predict the performances of submarines from open source data, open source data. So this is a German design, type 214, one of the newest submarines on the market with an AIP system. Here we see its layout, and we can talk about the divisions of a submarine from this image. So here there are the main thing with a submarine is to do surveillance and also carry weapons and attack if necessary. So submarine is the ship, as you know, to carry weapons and also the sensors, and also it requires a mobility system for sailing both on surface and underwater, and will also need a lot of ship support equipments, auxiliary machinery, etc. So when we are talking about a submarine, we know we have a propeller to propel the boat, generally seven-bladed or at least six-bladed propellers. Because it is an underwater ship, we need an electric motor and batteries, because underwater you cannot use your diesel engines as it is. So underwater, all submarines need some air-independent source. Either they are a nuclear reactor or batteries or air-independent propulsion, etc. So underwater, there is no diesel engine. But during a surface operation, it requires a diesel generator to charge batteries. And also, you need to have controllers to run the electric motor. And these types of German submarines has AIP systems. This is a fuel cell driven submarine. So if you have an independent propulsion, you will have a reactant or a kind of fuel to generate electricity. In this time, we have a metal hydride tanks to store hydrogen. And in all non-nuclear air-independent propulsion submarines, you need a cryogenic tank for oxygen storage. You will have a lot of auxiliary machineries, as all in all ships, but submarine is a very special type of ship. I read in an article, I don't remember in which, but they said if spaceship is not a ship, then the most complex ship is submarines. So this is also something which attracts me. So in CIC part, which is under the sail of the submarine, all the combat information center consoles or all controls are in this part. Here you see some consoles of sonar and other important electronic devices to control the ship. On the sail, you will have hoistable masts, a periscope, sail periscope, attack periscope, snorkel, and active sonar, radar, ESM, and other necessary sensors and optical electronic sensors we have here. In the forward part of German submarines, there generally are accommodation and in all like in all modern submarines, the torpedo room is at the forward of the ship. So there are torpedo storage, there are torpedo tubes in the front. So there are some other auxiliary machineries like high pressure air bottles. And at the aft of the this ship, there is a tow derrick sonar and a cylindrical sonar in the front. So I started to learn about submarines and see what is inside, but it was not enough for me to compare the design. So I need to find a more detailed way to compare it. As the name of the presentation and was my dissertation, it's comparative naval architecture of modern non-nuclear submarines. So I could not compare it with only some photos. So I should find a way to bring it a little deeper as far as I can. So we have told that there is a propeller, there are rudders, electric motors, and also during this thesis, I saw that the technology is improving, not very fast, not like electronics or computer science, but improving. So, for example, this electric motor on the right was the old type of Siemens electric motor. You can see how large it was on the image on the right. And the new types of permanent magnet electric motors, which is now in here is Siemens Permazin, which is much volume efficient than the old design. And I know that it's more effective also. So by improving these techniques, they are trying to build smaller ships. But also there are some other equipments like AIP systems and other stuff. So they need extra volume. If they make it smaller in the mobility systems and other stuff, so they can add newer type of equipments like AIPs without enlarging the submarine. So this is very useful for designers. And all, of course, there are diesel engines and AIP system here, 240 kilowatts AIP system. And there are cryogenic tanks and metal hydride tanks for hydrogen and cryogenic tank for oxygen. There are batteries, as we told, auxiliary systems and combat information center, a larger view of it, accommodation and torpedo storages, torpedo tubes, etc. So after this warm up about submarines, for the dissertation, I could reach information of 16 different submarines from different countries, all built after 1980. So they are relatively new types of ships. Almost all of them are still in use today. With German submarines, I studied on four different types. Type 209, which is even Turkey has, I think, 14 of these type of ships. Dolphin class, Germany built these ships for Israel, but there are also a lot of electronic and warfare, which was designed by Israel is also in this boat. There are type 212 class submarines. Germany uses this, these ships in their navy, and also Italia is also Italian navy also using these ships. And type 214 submarine, which we will use it. Six of them we will use, and I must say that type 209 was the it is, as far as I know, the there is no other type of submarine, new type of submarine which is built more than this ship. Number of built is 61. this type of ship. So there were also Russian submarine designs. Russia is a nuclear country, but also using in their navy diesel electric type submarines too. So we have Kilo class Amur and S-1000 submarines. Kilo is also built a lot, 73. Actually, Kilo is more than Type 209, as far as I see. And they have Amur class. They are still improving it. There is no, I think there is no one completed yet. And S-1000 submarine was a joint project with Italian Italians, but I think they cancelled this project with Russia, and I think they bought the rights of this design, Italians. And there were Swedish designs, Vasa Gotland, Collins, which Sweden built for Australians, and Gotland submarines. Gotland is a very famous submarine because they leased this submarine to United States for 2 years. And this was, as far as I know, the only the first submarine which built from scratch to have an AIP system. Is the first one, and it has a Stirling engine. We will talk about it. And also, there were Dutch and French submarines I've studied. Walrus class is still in use in Dutch Navy, and Moray 1400 submarine was a design. We had Scorpene, and Scorpene Plus was only a design which will be the improved version of Scorpene with a MESMA AIP system. There was also Upholder class, which is a British design, but now Canada is operating these submarines, and P650 submarine, which turned into S80, as far as I know, which was first planned to build a submarine with MESMA system, but then they changed it to a fuel cell. So these were six submarines which I choose to study further. About these submarines, this Upholder class was built but not further continued, because British said enough for classical submarines, continue only with nuclear ones. But I know there are some new designs for SS keys. And Scorpene was French design, and S80 and Scorpene Plus was variants of this design. Vasa Gotland was the submarine before Gotland was designed, and it was succeeded by Gotland. And also Collins was a Swedish design after Vasa Gotland. When we are talking about German designs, 209 was before Dolphin designs, and after Dolphin, you can see how it affected the design of 214 and 212 designs. Kilo still in use in a lot of navies, and Russia is improving Amur design, and S-1000 was also a variant of that. And Walrus, Dutch design, and Moray is designed but not yet built. by the Dutch Navy. So after all these information from internet, okay, it was a beginning, but as the naval architectural point of view, it was not enough to make a comparison. So during my studies, I read Concepts in Submarine Design book, which was written by Birchen and Rydell, and there I saw the Flounder diagram. They were talking about this diagram that designers are, when they are starting from scratch, instead of drawing a three-dimensional ship, they start the general arrangement of a pressure hull with a Flounder diagram. Flounder diagram is a 2D diagram which represents the volume, cross-sectional area, and the arrangement of the rooms and systems inside a pressure hull. So I decided to use these Flounder diagrams to compare the pressure hull design arrangement arrangements of the submarines which I choose. So I hand measured all the departments compartments of the submarines which I study on this thesis, and I hand measured and I prepared the Excel sheet to turn these hand measurements into volumes. So by this way, I could calculate their cross-sectional areas, compartment volumes, and thus I can represent them in Flounder diagrams. And after measuring all these compartments, I also draw their pressure chambers, pressure hulls, and compare if I have any calculation, an error with my calculation. So I checked if I miss anything. So it's kind of a check for my measurements. Then I prepared Flounder diagrams for all the ships I was studying about. So here you see type 212A, and it is Flounder diagram. So by this way, you can simplify the design, the arrangement of compartments of a ship. And also, after building, after measuring all these compartment volumes, I could represent these volumes in such graphs, and it is much simpler to compare. For example, what I found when I was looking for German submarines, because it was important, because Turkish Navy is also operating these submarines. Of course, I, as a naval architect, I expect navies, countries who build submarines for their navies to have some more stuff for their own navies. For example, with these German designs, I found out that in the export type submarines, which Germany does not operate in their own navy, has smaller CICs, which I think tells that for their own navy, they are using some more sophisticated equipment, which they don't sell in their export submarines. Dolphin is an also export, but as I said, it has Israel's own equipment for warfare. So these graphs made it a little simpler for me to compare all these designs. And you can also compare the relations between these compartments of a design. So maybe in for future studies, I will use these flounder diagrams for generating a preliminary design tool, like knowledge-based designs, etc. So it is what I did in comparison to concept in submarine design book. The designers use these flounder diagrams to design a submarine from scratch. But I did the reverse. There were submarines which was built, and I did a reverse to compare them and to check them in more detail. So I prepared all flounder diagrams of all 16 submarines. And for example, what I found about Russian submarine designs, Russians are very, very much interested, I think, about hydrodynamics. So in their designs, I think the era where this kilo submarine design was the teardrop shape of an underwater vehicle was very much the concern to have a better hydrodynamics. But this requires a lot of different molds to build your submarine's pressure hull. And it is much expensive, which we saw in German designs, for example. They almost all have cylindrical parallel mid body, so it's much easier to cheaper to build their pressure hulls. But as far as I see, Russians also lost this concern about tier drop shape, and they tried with Amur design to lower the building cost. And Swedish designs also has parallel middle body, and Valur's design was also very much concerned about teardrop shape, but Morai was also a parallel midbody, and also French, Spanish, and English designs are here. So, what other stuff I saw during this thesis? Different types of air-independent propulsion are necessary because the underwater endurance of classical submarines are not enough. They are all designers are improving their designs to have longer time underwater because it affects the submarine is a hidden ship in the water. So when they are submerged. So they try to keep as long as they can underwater, and only battery, demanding on only the battery is not enough. So designers are designing different types of air independent propulsion systems. So fuel cell is mostly known by German designs. They 1988, added a subsection to a 205 type design and propelled it with fuel cell. And from then, they added it to 214 and 212 submarines. What does the fuel cell do? It has a cryogenic oxygen tank, hydrogen storage, and using these fuels, they control it, and they produce electricity to charge their batteries or run their motors underwater, electric motors, and for their hotel loads. As I said, there are hydrogen metal hydride storages and oxygen storages on the submarine. This is a view of a fuel cell inside the submarine. And one other type of air independent propulsion was a Stirling engine, which was designed by Swedish designers, which was very famous because in drills, it sank United States aircraft carrier, which made even nuclear countries to think twice about air independent propulsion submarines, because they are very much quieter than nuclear ones. And that was the design of France, MESMA system. This is a kind of a nuclear reactor steam turbine without a reactor, but instead there is a combustion chamber which is used to produce steam and produce electricity. MESMA system is, as far as I know, only used in Pakistan Navy's Agusta class submarines, three of them. And even now, France is trying to generate fuel cells for their export type submarines. France is not operating classical submarines, only nuclear submarines in their navy. But for export, they built, design and built classical submarines too. And also, Dutch design of Moray had a closed cycle diesel engine, but it was only a design. But I'm pretty sure they built these kind of air independent propulsion systems. So maybe the next generation of Dutch Navy submarines, we will see this kind of air independent propulsion. So what I did also to compare these AIP submarines with each other. And what I found out, because I compared only the pressure hull inside volumes, this 212 submarine was the most efficient because it is a cryogenic tank was out of the pressure hull, so maybe to put it in this graph is to compare apples and oranges. So what we see, Gotland and Skorpene was quite less effective in volume. MESMA, fuel cell 214 was better efficiency, and closed cycle diesel engine had better efficiency in terms of the volume and arrangement. And also what I saw there are different kind of AIP systems, and there are different kind of ships. For example, this Morai type is like the Scorpene plus design. It's like an adding section AIP system. But there are also other types, like this 212 design. When you see this submarine, you see that the first concern of the designer was to put this air independent propulsion in order not to make the submarine larger, but fit in a certain volume and certain length of the ship. If you build it as an added section, like in the Scorpene design, you are enlarging the length of the ship. And then I wanted to do some comparison with the hydrodynamic performances. So I start again with the images. As I told about Russians' interest on teardrop shape, hydrodynamic shape of the ship, I saw that the modern designs do not really take that much attention on that teardrop shape, but a parallel middle body is chosen in a lot of newer designs. So the in order to make it cheaper to build the submarines, as far as I see. So I compared their L and B, L over B ratios, which you can see around 10. But from the resistance test with different type of bodies, actually it is known that the best efficiency is around 5.5 L over B, but it is not possible to build in such ratios. But when you see with the newer designs, designers are trying to, like in 2012, trying to keeping with a lower L over B ratio. And for AIP submarines, if you, like in Scorpene, if you add a module, it will definitely will enlarging your L over B ratio. From the images, what else I saw, there were symmetrical and asymmetrical shape of bow forms, which, as far as I know, is a concern about maneuvering, vertical maneuvering of submarines. And with the newer designs, I saw that the hydrodynamics of to make a more efficient hydrodynamic form, in order to make a more efficient hydrodynamic form, which also I believe affect the acoustics of submarine too. All these connection of sails and the body has smoother connections, which reduces the resistance of the sail type. In theory of submarine design by Kormelis and Kalizev, they told about how the efficiency, hydrodynamic efficiency change with the different sail forms. And on the top, you see Russian Alpha class submarines, which is one of the fastest one. And you see their streamlined connection with sail and the hull. So as far as I see from newer types of designs, it is also a concern of designers. With rudders, there are cross type or X type rudders. It all has pros and cons. But from this point, I stopped. I couldn't go further by only the images. So I need to find a more appropriate way to improve these comparison to make it a little more deeper. At that time, I found out from MIT's website that there are some master's thesis. At first, I read Torkelson's thesis, and then I, from its references, I found Stannard's thesis and Thornton's thesis. And by their thesis, I found about Dr. Harry Jackson and its, his submarine design notes, which was these theses were very useful for me to make this study a little more deeper. May he rest in peace, Harry Jackson. From these theses, I found out that for the preliminary design of ships, Harry Jackson introduced some simple empirical formulations. So I decided to use these formulations to, again, reversely calculate the hydrodynamic performance of those selected 16 submarines. For these, in order to make a calculation with these formulations, I need the wetted surfaces of submarines, propulsive coefficients, and battery capacities, etc. So all these information I tried to find from their photos and layout diagrams that I could reach. So I use these formulations to compare, make a more deeper comparison of these designs. In order to make, and in order to find these wetted surfaces, I draw the images of these old submarines from their by their photos and their layout diagrams. So I used wetted surfaces, which I measured from these drawings. And also for hot loads, I need the volumes which I previously measured from the designs. So for hot load prediction, Harry Jackson offered this formulation, a factor of mobility volumes, a factor of CIC volume, a factor of ship systems, and weapon volumes. So this formulation I also used for all type of submarines, but for relatively newer types of submarines, I thought that the electrical efficiency of these submarines are better than the old ones. So I used another formulation for newer kind of submarines. For the propulsive coefficient, this time I used the diagram, the table, which concept in submarine design Bercher and Rydell offered. So I used this formulation for these tables for calculating their propulsive coefficients. But for this They said this is for this changes propulsive coefficient of a submarine changes with its tail cone angle. So all the numbers I showed are for changing tail cone angles. So I had to measure these tail cone angles from layout diagrams of these ships in order to calculate their propulsive coefficients. And after that, by using those formulations, I draw their shaft horsepower curves of all 16 submarines, snorkeling shaft horsepower curves, their battery endurance ranges, their indiscretion rates, and their endurances, fuel endurances in days. And I also compared their provision range and fuel range in order to find what is the most optimum speed for these submarines. So in my thesis, I could generate these graphs, and I could only make it that deep. But after my thesis, as I said, I had chance to work with other friends, which was following also these formulations, and we tried to improve our calculations. So here the indiscretion rates and battery dependent submarine submerged ranges, even the submarine is a air independent one, like S1214-212 submarines, I only could manage to calculate their submerged ranges due to battery. So I couldn't add the extra underwater submerged duration due to the use of AIP. So with the newer students which I work with, I try to add also these, but also this formulation for propulsive coefficient was a little interesting to me. I want to dig it a bit deeper. But before that, how we calculated the eta zero, the propeller efficiency, was but we used in seance E 1619 generic propellers open motor curve to calculate in so instead of choosing one efficiency and one propulsive coefficient, we tried to make it more complex. So we found different ways to make it more accurate. So one we used was a real submarine propeller data. But about the propulsive coefficient, in my thesis, I only used this table. But then we found out also there are more detailed calculation in concepts in submarine design due to Tyler Wake fraction and thrust deduction. So you can choose your propeller's diameter or hull diameter, and you can choose your tail cone angle, and you can find your thrust deduction here, and Tyler fraction also the same way. So by this graph, you can make a better prediction. But what I found from theory of submarine design, Russians offer almost the opposite. Burchin and Rydell says that the propulsive efficiency increases with the tail cone angle. But Russians tell exactly the opposite. They said if you have a higher tail cone angle, you will have a lower propulsive coefficient. So this I wanted to investigate deeper, and my wife is also a naval architect, and for her PhD studies, we wanted to investigate. So one nuclear submarine designer country says it gets better with higher tail cone angle, and other nuclear submarine designer country says no, it is getting lower with the increase of the tail cone angle. So we wanted to investigate. So this is how we see it. Theory of submarine design says the red curves and black curves are from concepts in submarine design. So in order to investigate this with my wife's PhD study, we wanted to make resistance tests and self-propulsion tests with a submarine form. Here we used Darpa-Sabov design. That we investigated this the change in the tail cone, how it affects. We also used CFD for this. This is me. I was in our towing tank during these tests to for this setup. And this is a self-propulsion test we carried out by this in order to find out about this propulsive coefficient. And from our experiments, we found out that it neither increases nor decreases, but has an optimum value for the hull efficiency, propulsive coefficient. But in order to make a conclusion like this, only Darpa-Sabov experiment we found not enough. So we are doing the same experiments for a newer type of standard submarine hull form, BB2, Joubert. So after that, we will publish our findings. So after me, Dilşat Karataş also studied about these formulations. And for her, for his master's thesis, did a lot of improvements by with Sertaş Kurdoğlu, and we improved, and we think we did a more accurate computation than which I have done. So all these computations we used the open source data, what we found from internet, layout diagrams from books, photos. We tried to make their drawings, 3D drawings, take wetted surfaces and for hull and sail and rudders, etc., from those drawings. And by using the formulations which suggested by Harry Jackson, we draw these submarines power cores. And how we find out the battery capacity in order to calculate the under submerged endurance of submarine from kilo class, because they had a lot of information in the internet, we found out that the net volume of the area arranged for batteries is 65% of the area is arranged for batteries. So when we, in order to make a calculation with these formulations suggested by Harry Jackson, we need NC, number of cells. So from the layout, we need to find out how many cells are there in that battery room. But it is not possible. But what possible was to measure the volume of battery room. So I found out that the volume which I measured from a submarine has 4.6 cells per meter cube. So by this number, if I measure a battery room's volume, I can estimate how many standard submarine batteries are inside in that volume. So by using these numbers, I could find out the battery capacity of the submarine. But this battery capacity changes with the speed, the underwater speed of the submarine. So this formulation is an iterative formulation, and it changes with the speed, as you can see in the graph. For the higher speeds, you can use a less capacity. For lower speeds, you can use more of the capacity. So by these formulations, we could calculate the red lines, these battery only submerged discharge times of those submarines. In Dishas thesis, we used only fuel cell submarines, which was S-1000, S-212, and S-214. So these were our predictions for their underwater endurances. And for snorkeling condition, which was I found not very accurate from Harry Jackson's formulations, I found out this CH term by these numbers from some existing designs, and by this way we could calculate the necessary time to charge our batteries with a snorkeling sail. But the higher your snorkeling speed, the less power you can use to charge your batteries. So these formulations can help calculating these. So this TR is the time required to charge your batteries with changing speeds. And by using this TR and TD was the submerged here. TD was the submerged duration of discharge time. And by knowing this TR and TD for different speeds, you can measure you can calculate your indiscretion rate. So what with D-shot thesis we done, the battery only indiscretion rates we computed. And this far, I could came by myself during my thesis, which is in D-shot thesis, we did it, I think, more accurately. We had no chance to compare with the actual ones, because even the one that Turkish Navy operates, I don't have their data, because it's secret and I don't have a permission to reach them, because I'm not in Navy. But we also wanted to improve these our computations by including the AIP's performance, because it changes a lot. So by computing only the battery only duration of an AIP submarine is no sense. We need to find out how the AIP improves the performance. But as I said, I need to find a way to compute battery capacity. In order to make a computation for AIP, also I need to find out the fuel which submarine had. So, but this fuel is hydrogen, and also there is an oxidant, oxygen. But because hydrogen tanks are small and in many different places of the submarine, the hydrogen capacity is very hard to be reached from open source data, from the photos we found. But the oxygen was stored in a cryogenic tank, so it is more easier to calculate its volume. So what we have done, from the layout, we measured the oxygen capacity of the cryogenic tank. And in Thornton's thesis, it gave he gave some coefficients to calculate from a cryogenic tank to real oxygen capacity. So by measuring these volumes, we found out the we estimated the capacity of oxygen which a submarine has. But this oxygen was not only for fuel cell. Also, the requirement of personnel in the submarine also breeds this oxygen. So we need to subtract by multiplied by personnel number and their consumption of oxygen by man hour. So these formulations are also from Thornton's thesis, but this helped us to calculate the AIP endurance of a submarine. At first, during another student's thesis, we used this formulation, but we had to make an estimation that only to a certain up to a certain speed this fuel cell can be used. After that certain speed, only a battery is used. So we had to make such an assumption during that thesis. But I think this was not enough. So we need to find a way to see the air independent propulsions influence on all the speeds which submarine can sail. So what we did with Dilshad's thesis, we found out from internet these Sinavi fuel cells efficiency graphs. From the first graph, from the required discharge power, we found out the ampere current which fuel cell is operating, and in the second graph gives the efficiency versus the current which the submarine demand the power from fuel cell. So we implement also these curves into our code in order to make a better prediction. The power we are taking from fuel cell also changes its efficiency. So we calculate the efficiency in this formulation, changing with the kilowatt. So we have two formulations for underwater time. One is dependent on battery only, and the second one is dependent on the fuel cell only. But as far as I said in the previous slide, it was not enough to calculate battery and add fuel cell, because after some speed, fuel cell is not capable enough to run the submarine in that speed. But it is not absent during these speeds, so it needs to be calculated. But this brings us to a point that we have two formulations for two equations with two unknowns, but they are non-linear multivariable constraint functions. So we need to make make an optimization for each higher speed, for each speed at first the speeds up to fuel cell and battery can operate together and can can run the submarine by themselves. But also the higher speeds that fuel cell only assists. So, but this also improves the underwater time in actual case. So we used F-Mincon optimization tool of MATLAB to find the minimum of a constraint nonlinear multivariable function. Here, what were our constraints? First was the discharge time, which we are trying to find actually. So we give, this will be definitely a positive one, which is limited by zero. So, and the maximum value we limited by 1,000 hours. So X1 was what we are looking for. The X2 is the power which can be delivered by the fuel cell, which must also be a positive number, so it's limited. The lower boundary was zero, but the upper boundary was 240 kilowatts for during these calculations. So for we need to make the calculations in two parts. So first part is where battery and fuel cell oxygen will finish at the same time. But in the second part, battery will finish earlier because at higher speeds, battery is dominant and will finish earlier than the oxygen of the fuel cell. So we separated our curves in up to 8 knots and the speeds over 8 knots. And for with these new computations, we made computations again for battery only and also the battery plus AIP underwater durations of these three submarines. We found from BMT, submarine power and propulsion application to technology to delivery customer benefit. They also presented a paper in 2008 in Glasgow, which they also calculated the battery only and battery and AIP submerged durations of different kind of submarines. In this study, we also have the Type 214. So because we don't have the actual data of the ship to check, either we could do a good estimation, we didn't have the actual data, but we had the data, gentlemen from BMT company shared in their paper. So what we did is to compare our results with them. We found out from this comparison that we estimated, we predicted the battery only duration more optimistic than them, but the AIP plus battery, they were more optimistic than us. But we don't know how they made these calculations, so we cannot check which one is more accurate. But we, into this graph they shared, we added also our predictions, but as I said, there is a lot of gap with our prediction and there, so maybe adding our this ITU predictions, maybe to compare apples and oranges. I don't know what we want to show this also. So underwater ranges also be calculated by using these formulations, and integration rates, also the battery only and battery plus AIP integration rates. We want to show the upper graphs couldn't capture the lower speeds, so we also build a more detailed integration rate graphs for lower speeds for both all three submarines. My presentation is finished, so sorry I exceed the time. Thank you for your attention.
Mr. Johnson, thank you for this nice presentation. Okay, now you can ask your questions on the question screen, and we are waiting now to coming questions from you. Okay, no question. And I have a question from you to you, Mr. Johnson. How can you decide to research about this topic?
Thank you. yes, actually, it should be something I should mention in the beginning. As I said, Turkey does not design its own submarines. We are operating German designs. Before, we had some American ships. But in Turkey, we built our indigenous corvette design. So now I think the next step will be to design our submarines. But before starting to design a submarine, I think it is the best to know as far as as deep as you can to know about existing designs. So I thought it will be useful for our design studies to study different countries' designs as deep as possible. As I said, so comparing only the photos and the general information you can find actually from Wikipedia was not enough for me, and I wanted to investigate some other methods which are in use by submarine designing countries. So the first part was about the volume and arrangement comparisons. I found out that a Flounder diagram is being used by designers. So I wanted to represent all these volume arrangements of different submarines in these Flounder diagrams. I measured them, I drew them, and also this information can be also used by your, for example, when you are designing a new submarine. You would need to know how much a volume you need to be arranged for your, for example, engine room. If you have not designed any submarine before, this will be something unknown to you. But I thought if I measure 16 different submarines' engine rooms, then I could make a statistical convergence to such a value that for a certain engine power, I would need a I could find the coefficient for kilowatt and volume. So I could use these coefficients to calculate the required engine room. This is same for auxiliary machinery and machinery rooms, generator rooms, battery rooms. So the first part was about this. And the second part was all these graphs. The actual graphs are very well known by the designers and the operators of these submarines, but they are secret information. So they don't share this in the internet. But I found out that this methodology, which Harry Jackson offered to predict your preliminary designed submarine, the performance of that submarine, if this can be used to predict a newly designed submarine, I thought it would also be used in reverse. If I know the or estimate the wetted surface of a submarine and its battery capacity and its propulsive coefficients, and by using these formulations, I can calculate the hydrodynamic performance, endurance, and even indiscretion rate of a submarine in reverse. So that's what I did to gain a better understanding about these existing designs and compare them.
Thank you for your answer. And okay, the next question is came from Sarp Güranlı. How do you see the future of civilian submarines?
I think submarines are getting even more importance in our age. It was kind of around for two, three decades. It was in a rather small, slow improvement happened, I think, in submarine science. But the world is now changing. We are in Turkey. We feel its influences on in Mediterranean and also in Black Sea, and China is getting a lot of power. And after the clash of Soviet system, Russia lost some power. But now they are gaining power again and investigating a lot in submarines. Even only in this year, Russia is launching three nuclear submarines. It is a lot. About 10 years ago, Russia couldn't finish their one Akula class submarines, and India sponsored and bought that submarine. But now Russia is building even their nuclear propelled torpedoes. So they are investing a lot, and all other countries are investing a lot about submarines. About civilian submarines, 10 years ago, there was not so much about these leisure crafts. But now there are a lot of different brands. We cannot call them actually submarines. They are more submersibles, touristic submersibles. But a lot of businessmen in their luxury yachts has those submarines, submersibles now. And also touristic submarine business is also gaining importance every day. I think our future is quite good time for submarine designers. I think there will be a lot of jobs both in civilian and military sector, I think.
Thanks for your answer for this question. Okay, the next question is asked by Eric. Mr. Eric, thank you for a very interesting presentation. What do you hope to use this work for?
My submarine design is my passion. I'm not involved in any military type design yet. But yes, my professional ambition is to design submarines. So I want to use these informations to design submarines one day somewhere, I hope in Turkey.
Okay, thank you. And the next question is asked again by Sarp Gurenli. Do you think the Turkey would be able to develop submarines for civilian use?
Yeah, this is not a government issue. So maybe tomorrow a businessman want to have a touristic submarine, and they can offer, and they can start a business with that. And I think it will be very good for Turkey, because I'm also a diver, spear fisherman, and I know how fascinating the underwater is. So I think it will be quite a good business to have touristic submarines, especially in our southern parts of Turkey. So okay. It is very easy actually to have such a submarine. These kind of submarines are almost 100 years old. So for 100 years, people are building such submarines. Only in Hawaii, I think there are 5 touristic submarines. So why not in Antalya? Why not in Bodrum?
Yes, you are right, and thanks. And okay, Mr. Mark Henry gave us a suggestion. Please provide contact information. And okay, and the next question is asked by Mustafa Kara. I would like to know if there is any ongoing efforts to do some research on the operational, logical, and physical architecture on non-nuclear submarines. There has been major research activities on these subjects, naval surface ships. I would like to know if you would consider such research on submarines as well.
For the first suggestion, here is my email address, both from university and for personal. You can get in touch with me to further discuss about the topic I presented. I know also in attendees, maybe there are people who have much more experience than me. I would appreciate their knowledges, their suggestions to improve these computations. And for the second question, as I said, I am a civilian. I'm not involved, and nobody asks actually yet to be involved in the research on submarines. All the presentation, all the studies I presented in this presentation were me and my friends' initiative. So we want our country to design submarines. We are naval architects, and We spend some time and dig as deep as we can to maybe to share some to make it simpler for them. So or if Turkey wants to design its own submarines, so the studies which I presented for in this presentation was I think the first steps to start submarine design, to know as deep as you can about the existing designs.
Okay, thank you. And the next question is asked by Sarper Iştenlik. First of all, thank you for your presentation. As a sophomore naval architect student, what is your advices for me to improve my submarine design knowledge? Also, what is your advice for working on submarine design in our country? Which areas I need to improve myself for working on submarine projects in Turkey or in other countries?
This is a very hard question to answer, but maybe I can. This is not my answer to this question, but I had a chance to meet with a submarine designer who was retired from a very famous shipyard and was the mechanical and electrical manager of those submarine designs and buildings. I asked him what would he advise to someone with a passion about submarines. He answered to my question that be open to all the all information, try to learn everything, try to accept all the jobs you have been offered, and try to gain all the information you can in any part of the naval architecture. But also try to be an expert in one subject. So the submarine design submarine design is not only these hydrodynamics, not only these arrangements, but strength calculations is another topic which is very deep. Maneuvering of submarines is another world. Resistance propulsion is another. Submarine systems are another very deep subject. So propeller design, acoustic, mechanical vibration, shock design, all these subjects are very deep. And he told me to pick a subject that you will be the master on that subject, but don't find enough to know only that topic, but get any knowledge on also different subjects which involved in submarine design. So he was his answer to me, and I'm passing this answer to you.
Okay, thank you. And the next question comes from Mr. Benjamin Gray. And thank you for the great presentation. I was fascinated about the discrepancies you found for the tail cone angles and propulsive coefficients. Have you found any other differences when looking at published theoretical equations?
I don't remember any other things, but it is I felt very how can I say I was very happy during the preparation of this presentation because it was like a kind of butterfly effect. So I decided to work during my bachelor's of science degree dissertation with this design with this subject, but by finding the formulations that Harry Jackson suggested, I could make it a little deeper, my comparison of these submarines. And this influenced a lot of my friends, my younger friends, who also worked on this topic. They improved my codes. And now the code we produce is much better than the first code I could started. So it was like a butterfly effect. And after my dissertation, a lot of my friends had their Bachelor of Science dissertations on this topic. Also, Dilşat's master's thesis was he improved the code a lot, and also this tail cone angle, the effect of tail cone angle in propulsive coefficient, we found it by also working with these empirical formulations. So, in order to make it a little more accurate, we found that different books and found the difference between British and Russian designers' suggestions for propulsive coefficients. And this turned out a PhD thesis. We studied it with CFD, first computational fluid dynamics calculations. And then we found out that there is no self-propulsion data about submarines to make a benchmark study for our CFD calculations. So we are calculating something, but we are not sure if we are calculating it correctly or not. So we designed the test system for Atanutku ship model basin. And we did these experiments, and for the first time, maybe I'm not sure if any other papers are presented in symposium on naval hydrodynamics, which is organized by U.S. Navy Office of Naval Research. We presented this paper about these self-propulsion experiments in Hamburg in 2018 Symposium of Naval Hydrodynamics. This symposium is the, I think, the best in hydrodynamics science, the top symposium. So this was one of our dream before we retire, actually, to make a study good enough to be elected as a paper in this symposium. So by this butterfly wing effect, it turned out a PhD thesis, and the study was selected as a selected paper in that symposium, and also a paper is published in his name is the Journal of Ship Research, which is very influential journal. So if I wouldn't choose a topic, and if I would be tired to work, study deeper about this subject, and if I couldn't reach, or if I didn't read the thesis of students from MIT, I will not find Harry Jackson, and this I will not have a question about propulsive coefficients. I will not know about the difference of these tail cone angles. So I wish he would be still alive and I could talk him.
Thank you. And the next question came from Mrs. Maria. As you join together the information of many submarines, which reference do you recommend to go deeper with the submarine design?
I couldn't answer the question. Which reference? You mean the books? Books about submarines?
Actually, I think maybe it's submarine type or on the, yeah. Because yeah, the information of many submarines. I think the submarine type.
What I found out, actually, I could not say that this design is better than this. But what I found out that all countries has different rule of thumbs about their designs. Some try to make it more simple. Some try to make it more reliable. For example, once I was in Hamburg, and near Hamburg, there was in Labo, where a Second World War German submarine museum is there. So the first day I was in German submarine from Second World War, and the other day there was a Russian submarine which was bought by a German businessman and turned into a museum. So these being inside of these two submarines are very different. When I was in a Russian submarine, I see that there are a lot of backups of their system. So they build a lot of submarines. They know where can the failure happen, and all systems has their backups in German designs. Sorry, in Russian designs. But for example, German submarines were much simple designs. And I had a chance to meet a gentleman from Rubin Design Bureau, which is famous for designing a lot of Russian nuclear submarines. And they said they also think the same. If there is a way not to put something in a submarine, Germans choose that option. not to put it, so it won't fail, etc. But Russians invested a lot in submarines, almost an unlimited budget for submarines during Soviet time, Cold War time. They produced a lot of different design, a lot of different equipments. So they used all this knowledge in their designs to make more reliable submarines, more powerful submarines. But they know they can fail, and they want all the backups. From my friend, who is a known submarine designer, he said the same for Swedish submarines. Swedish submarines are even more simple designs than German ones. So the designs changes with the rule of thumb of the designer country, as far as I see. So I cannot say this is better or that is better. But what I can see is the information I find out about comparing the volumes of pressure valves. The best submarine is your country's own design, I think. Because you can see it from the combat information center volumes, I think.
Okay, and so also
export type submarine, you are not buying the state of the art. Because all countries spare their best knowledge for their own navies. In export designs, they don't want to put the state of the art.
Okay, and thanks. And also, she gave answers to clarify her question. Her question is related to references and papers or books and other things. And do you have any suggestion or anything else?
I think these two books are still the best options, I think. The Concepts in Submarine Design and Theory of Submarine Design. As I said, Russians has a lot of experience about submarine designs, but there is only one book they published, and I was fascinated by the reference list of Theory of Submarine Design. There were a lot of Russian papers and books in the references, but all in Russian languages. And actually for that, for 2 years, I'm studying Russian language. So I want to learn Russian enough to understand and read the papers and books about submarines, which I may find in Russian a bookstore in Russia, for example. I'm sure they don't share every knowledge in open sources, but they don't publish a lot in English still. The gentleman which I get in touch during some international conferences, even they are very good at their subjects, they don't speak English because they don't need. They had a lot of information in their own language, so they don't publish, they don't spend time to study English. So That's why I'm trying to learn Russian language. But concepts in submarine design and theory of submarine design, I think the good references to start. And there are also different books published about, for example, from an Australian author published a good book about submarine hydrodynamics, which is not in general submarine design, but more focused on submarine hydrodynamics. And there are a lot of papers, especially in hydrodynamics, there are a lot of works like the one we studied, Darpasabov. So this keyword would be very useful for a student. If you write Darpasabov to Google, you will find a lot of information about submarine hydrodynamics, maneuvering. There are a lot of reports of David Taylor Model Basin published. dome.mit.edu. You can find there a lot of reports. So these will be good references to start and go deeper.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Johnson. And now we are closing to sharing a time of us name. And so for this reason, apologize to coming questions. And but you can send email, Mr. Johnson. And now.
Happy to read your questions and further discussion of this topic. I'm sorry I couldn't manage it to fix in 1 hour. Sorry for not answering your questions right now, but I will answer your email. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Now we are finishing this webinar. If you have any questions, also you can send email Mr. Johnson. First of all, thank you, Mr. Johnson, for this nice presentation and event. Thank you for SNAME support and help organizing this event. Finally, thank you for your pay attention for this webinar. You can follow next SNAME webinar on SNAME website. You all have a good day. Bye.
Thank you very much.